All right. So I wanted to go into the whole reading the soil test to make recommendations thing. I generally do it before lunch, but you guys are so full of good questions that we didn't get to it. Usually what happens with the questions is you cover stuff that we were going to cover later.
Yep.
So it's not like we're not on schedule. It's just that we're doing things in a little different order. But I am going to focus on the soil testing details right now for a little while. So this is mostly pages 2, 3, and a little bit of 4 that we're going to be covering besides the soil test report form, if you want to get those all out so you can look at them all at the same time. So the top two slides on page 2, slide number 7, slide number 8, those are your target levels from a from an Albrecht style. Page 2 is its own page. Doesn't have a back to it.
What about 39?
As they're not on here?
Yeah, I didn't see them.
Give me a minute and we'll get to them. When I was printing these out on Thursday, I didn't print out pages 2 and 4 for some reason. I think I pressed the wrong button on the photocopier, so it took pages 1 and 2 and pages 3 and 4 and put 1 and 3 on there and ignored 4 and 2. So 2 and 4 are separate pages and 1 and 3 are front and back. It's not the way it should be. I apologize. All right, so just going through this handout here on top page 2, target levels of macrominerals and target levels of trace elements. These are your targets. This is something I've gotten basically from talking to a number of elders in the field, people who've been doing consulting and stuff for a few decades. When I first started learning about this, and there was no answer in one book, like this is the answer. It was everybody had their own ranges, and so I talked to Jerry Brunetti, I talked to Gary Zimmer, I talked to Arden Anderson, I talked to Bruce Tanio, I talked to Neil Kinsey. I'm not sure if anybody knows all these people's names, but maybe you know a couple of the names. I basically went up to them all and said, what's the deal, guys? Like, how are young people who are just learning about this supposed to figure this out, because you guys are all saying different stuff?
Yep.
So I went and I asked them all, I said, every single one of you, I said, what's your targets? And then when I got in everybody's targets, I went back to them all and said, now what do you think about, this is what Gary said, but that's what, you know, Bruce said, what do you think now? And so we basically weaned it down to a basic target level, which is what I've got here. It's not perfect, it's a ballpark. Don't get too worked up about numbers in general, as far as I'm concerned. We have been trained to trust scientists and doctors and lab reports and I think a little bit too much. So people feel comfortable when they got numbers, they can work towards it, that makes them feel safe. Some people, I just wanna say this is a ballpark, this is a target area, this is not like a totally get uptight about it kind of thing. What we're really looking for is which ones are way off and which ones are kind of close. Anybody who's studied agronomy may have heard of this thing called Liebig's barrel. Anybody heard of Liebig's barrel? Liebig,
yeah.
Justus von Liebig is considered to be the father of conventional ag, you know, soluble nutrients, chemistry. Liebig's barrel is, you know, pictured as a old whiskey barrel or wine barrel cut in half. You know, people have sometimes these tomato planters in a barrel kind of a thing. So each of these staves is represented by a mineral. So we got calcium, we got magnesium, we got boron, we got sulfur, we got phosphorus, we got copper, etc. So when you read your, when you get your soil test back and you see, okay, calcium is at 75% of where it's supposed to be. Magnesium is at 80% of where it's supposed to be. Boron's at 15% of where it's supposed to be. Sulfur's at 10% of where it's supposed to be. Phosphorus is at 50% and copper is at 40%. Liebig's barrel says, this is your yield potential. If everything was up at full, then you could actually realize the full yield potential of your crop. People, minor side note, I'm sorry, I have too many side notes. Yield potential on corn, let me know, yield potential on corn?
175.
That's the yield average.
No, yield potential
is 400.
400.
1,000 to 1,200. bushels per acre is the yield potential on field corn, according to the geneticists at Purdue, at Iowa State. The corn geneticists that have done the research, 5-6 years per plant, easy. The yield potential, according to the corn geneticists, is 1,000 to 1,200 bushels per acre. Average yield in this country is between 140 and 160, once, you know, ish. So what percent of yield is that?
Maybe
15 if you want to be generous. Anybody go to school?
Maybe you got a 15.
And we got a 15 on a final exam? What do you call that? A big fat F. I took organic chemistry in college, and my final exam was a 35 or 34 or something in that range. And I got a D on my report card because they grade on the curve when everybody fails. And that's where ag culture is right now, is we're all failures. We're all really bad failures. And we're basically like allowed to stay going, but we're barely passing, right?
Yeah.
So Liebig's barrel says, okay, sulfur's at 10% of yield, sulfur's at 10% of where it needs to be, therefore your yield will never be 10% of the yield potential, right? That's it. So we look at these things kind of from this perspective. Okay, I know I need 75 parts per million sulfur. I know I've got 7.5 parts per million. That's a priority. Calcium's kind of close to where it needs to be. Magnesium's not too far off. Don't get too worked up about the details. Identify which ones are totally off and start working with those first. It's my general rule of thumb. If there's any violation to that, it's calcium, and calcium is really important. And calcium is generally really cheap. So, you know, as far as I understand, dollars per acre on limestone to address the deficiency is
Do you use limestone?
Depending on the pH and depending on the crop that I'm producing, I like to use this thing called carbonatite, which is a volcanic mineral. I mean, limestone is, you know, basically old seashells, old ocean, diatoms, basically, that fell in the ocean. And it's generally relatively poorly available. But at least where I come from, ag lime is like $8 a ton. I'm not sure what it's like down here. I can't believe it would be that
about
much more expensive. 40?
40 some.
Spread?
Yeah.
Spread. Well, it's $8 a ton at the quarry.
Yeah, it's only $6 spread. I probably charge the spread.
Well, there's hauling and stuff.
I'm not sure about the details. Okay. In my mind, when I'm making $25,000 an acre, $60 an acre is not a lot of money. But I understand when you're doing pasture, then it's a different conversation. So it's all, everybody's got to take into consideration where they're at. Generally, what you know, people who I have learned from have said is, don't try to do everything everywhere all at once. Start with a couple of acres and do a couple acres well and see if it's true or not and see what the increase in yield is and see if actually that investment will turn back money that you can put back into the land. Don't expect you're going to be able to do this, you know, cash flowing it all at once. You know, put aside some money, put it in, try to do things well. If it's true and if it works, it'll make you more money, which you can then put back into the land, and you can have more confidence and more, you know, experience with what you do need to do and what you don't need to do. In general, we're looking for which ones are most totally deficient as the priorities to address. Okay. For people who are working on backyard gardens, I'm guessing there's at least a couple of people in here that are not working on acres, but are working on hundreds of square feet or thousands of square feet. I've got this slide called conversions. I'm going to teach you how to read a soil test and make recommendations on pounds per acre. So 500 pounds per acre equals 11.5 pounds per thousand square feet. So you can just basically do some quick, you know, back of the envelope math. Slide number, it's page 2.
I find it much easier to work with.
You're on page 3.
400 pounds per acre is equal to 1 pound or 10 pounds per 100 square feet or 1 pound per 100 square feet.
Because this 42,000.
Yeah, and you can, 2.5 times 400 is 1,000 pounds per acre. It's a lot easier to work in your head.
Yeah. What he's saying is to ballpark it, so there's 42,000 plus or minus square feet in an acre.
43,000.
43,000.
360.
560, 640.
560.
Ballpark. He was getting rid of the 2,000 or 3,000. He was going straight to 40,000 square feet to do his back of the envelope math, which is 400 pounds per acre equals 10 pounds per 1,000 square feet.
That's what Terry Reams taught me.
Because it's all ballparks.
Yeah.
Let's not get too caught up in the details and too anal about, you know, well, I'm right?
It just makes it easier to work in your head.
Perfect. Yeah. So 400 pounds per acre equals 10 pounds per 1,000 square feet.
Or 1 pound per 100.
Or 1 pound per 100 square feet. Yeah. Anyway, don't want to spend a lot of time on that. Just it's there in the handout for you if you want. Okay, now, so here's the, this is the key piece on how to read a soil test. This is a secret that the agronomists know and you guys don't. Ready? Once you know this, everything else is simple math. Pretty simple. Parts per million times 2 equals pounds per acre. Everybody got that? That's all you need to know to read a soil test and make recommendations. Everything else is simple math.
That's because they assume it's 6 inches of
because
soil
they assume
equals
there's
2 million pounds.
2 million pounds of soil on the top 6 inches of an acre, which is the aerobic zone, which is where the biology is pulling the nutrients out from. Exactly. Exactly. So that's what that slide there, number 10, says. So we can pretty much go straight to the soil report and start doing the math here. And we'll figure out pretty quick that once you know how to do one mineral, you can do them all. Because you're just doing some basic math. So I'm not sure if you can read the label here. This is growing area north N/S, which is the first line. So we'll just run all of our numbers off of this one here. The first element is sulfur. See that?
Yep.
All right. So let's do sulfur. So what's the target level of sulfur?
75.
PPM times 2 equals 150 pounds per acre. Yeah? Okay, what does the soil report tell us? How much we've got present?
16.
We're reading the first one.
16.
16 parts per million times 2 equals 32 pounds per acre. We need 150, we got 32. What do we do? You guys are high tech here. Reading a soil test is really simple. 118 pounds per acre sulfur needed. Complicated? Difficult?
No.
Stressful? High math? That's our. This is our deficiency. We figured out how much sulfur we need in this acre. This is the easy part. Now we got to figure out what form your sulfur is going to come in. Mm-hmm. Right. All these elements you're looking for: calcium, potassium, magnesium, phosphorus, boron, copper, zinc, etc. You don't ever find them in their pure form. You don't ever find pure sulfur. You don't find pure calcium. You don't find pure potassium. So. What I have written down in the next couple of pages are how much sulfur is in this, how much sulfur is in that, how much potassium is in this. What's that?
Oh, I just, when I first started learning about it, trying to figure out how much was in each product and what I
yes.
could get and, you know, what was organic. Was
like, oh, my God.
I had to have a spreadsheet just to figure out what.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I've got a few examples here of things that, and I actually, on this sulfur, for example, slide, you can see slide number 11. I did the math out for you on gypsum, which is a common source of sulfur, calcium sulfate. Anybody who wants to know the background chemistry to figure out, how do you figure out how much sulfur is in gypsum? I did the math out for you here. So you can see the atomic weight of calcium is 40, the atomic weight of sulfur is 32, the atomic weight of oxygen is 16, hydrogen is 1. So you add up the atomic weights of CaSO4 plus 2H2O, and you get a total atomic weight of 172. And then you figure out what percentage of that is sulfur. You don't need to do this. It's totally unnecessary. But some people are science-y kind of people. They want to know, actually, how do you get these numbers? Why should I trust you? So this is the basic science behind it, is you read the atomic weights. The upshot is 100 pounds of gypsum is 23.5 pounds of calcium and 19 pounds of sulfur, which means that gypsum is 19% sulfur. Yeah? 19 pounds out of 100 pounds means 19%?
Yeah.
All right, great. So this is where you have one algebraic equation. If you're a person like me, you do the math in your head, and you round off 19% to 20%, and then you can just sort of divide this by, you know, 5, and you get your answer. I multiply by 5. But so we have 118 pounds. So this is the one algebraic equation in this whole process. Is you take 118 and you divide it by the percent concentration of sulfur, which in this case is 19. That's the concentration, 19%. So you do 118 divided by 0.19. Anybody got a calculator?
Yeah, 621.
621 pounds per acre gypsum needed.
So what do you do in this situation if you're also relying on gypsum as your calcium source?
Yeah.
And it doesn't, that amount doesn't meet.
This is why I'm doing gypsum as an example, because this is something you're going to come up against.
Yeah.
So let's do calcium. So calcium, if you look here on this section right here, they've done the math for you and found we've got a deficit of 112 parts per million. So 112 ppm times 2 equals 224 ppa calcium needed. All right? Gypsum gives us what percent calcium?
23.
So 224 divided by 0.235 equals?
About 1,000.
About 1,000. Looks pretty close to 1,000 to me.
1,000 pounds per acre. And we need
224 came from 112. We have a deficit of 112 parts per million of calcium.
Okay.
Which you multiplied times 2 to get pounds per acre.
Okay. I'm just trying to use yours and then try to do mine.
At the same time.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you have to add.
We're going to do this about 4 times.
Okay.
By the time you get done with it, you're like, oh.
So with the 621, you don't have enough calcium.
Right.
So you have to do 400.
So we have 100 plus or minus 1,000 pounds of mm-hmm. gypsum. Mm-hmm. So we need 621 pounds of gypsum to address the sulfur deficiency. We need 1,000 pounds of gypsum to address the calcium deficiency.
So we have to do 621 and find something.
You sure aren't going to do.
Right.
We're going to address deficiencies. We're not going to overdose things.
Right?
And there's one last step in here, which is slow and steady wins the race. Anybody ever heard of this? Slow and steady wins the race?
Yeah.
My understanding from talking to people who've been doing this for 30 years is just because you need a whole bunch of stuff does not mean putting it all on is a good idea. So you'll see that page 3 of this handout is entirely maximum yearly applications. And the idea here is, even if your tank is empty, filling it all up in 1 year is not what is recommended. Slow and steady wins the race. Put a little bit on and come back and check again. And then put a little bit more on and come back and check again. Don't put everything on all at once. If you got a bunch of money and you want to go for it, knock yourself out. What people have generally told me is, in this case, actually sulfur is on the bottom of page 2. So sulfur with calcium needed. 500 pounds per acre gypsum. People see that? Bottom of page 2. So we're going to do 500 pounds of gypsum. That's the answer. And if we want to do some calcium, we can do limestone.
Limestone.
gypsum does have.
This says a maximum of 500 pounds.
Of gypsum.
Calcium too.
If we need sulfur with calcium,
okay.
We do gypsum. If you look on the calcium slide, mm-hmm. which is over here on top page 3, 500 to 2,000 pounds of limestone. Slow and steady. Basically what's going on is the soil is a digestive system. The soil is a gut. It's bacteria and fungi. And I don't know, what do they say? Thanksgiving dinner? Anybody ever eaten Thanksgiving dinner?
Yep.
Eaten too much? Mm-hmm. What happens?
Indigestion.
You get groggy.
Yeah.
Right? Do you want your soil to get groggy? You want your soil to maintain good levels of energy. You want to, you know, get up from the table with your belly half, you know, half full.
Takes a lot of energy.
Takes a lot of energy to digest these things, which is one reason why you want to put them down in the fall, and one reason why you want to not put down everything all at once. When it comes to spreading minerals, as far as I'm concerned, the best way to spread minerals is through a digestive system like a compost pile. So anybody who's making compost, if you've got a bedded pack. You guys do bedded packs down here, or you don't do bedded packs because it doesn't get cold enough?
What is it?
Bedded pack. Up in Vermont, say, when it gets down to 40, 50 below zero, and people have cows, they don't keep their cows outside in the winter. They have like a big, you know, pole barn or a big hoop house or something. It's just shelter. It's just one layer of shelter, and they loaf in there. And they basically will come in and they'll put down bedding, whether it's wood chips or hay or whatever, on a regular basis. And you keep doing that every day for 5 months because that's how long it's cold for. And by the end of the winter time, by the time the grass starts to grow, you got 4.5-5 feet of, you know, raw of amazing raw material for a compost pile. So then they go in there with the bobcats or the excavators and pull it all out and pile it up. Or they feed pigs grade on it. There's all kinds of different ways of doing it. That'll compost, and you've got a, you know, wonderful, then you've taken all the manure and all the urine from all the cows, and you can actually put your minerals down in that bedding pack too. So what you do is you say, okay, cows are getting milked. I'm gonna go put the new bedding down for them. Before you put the bedding down, you throw a few handfuls of your gypsum and your copper sulfate and your boron, and you put that down in the bedding. You put the next layer of bedding down, they poop on it. When you pull all that stuff out in the spring and pile it up, it composts. And you've taken all your minerals and you've composted them. And so when you spread that compost, you've got a really high test compost because it's got all these minerals digested and much more bioavailable than they would be if you just spread them on the ground. That's the long and short of it. That's a bedded pack. It seems like the farther south I go, the fewer people do it. I think it's a good idea in general to be capturing all that manure and using it for your farm if you use nitrogen anyways. People do know about compost. They do know about composting. And so anybody who makes compost in general, I would suggest putting your minerals into your compost pile is a good idea. It'll help digest them. I personally don't use compost. What's that?
I think you put a lot less and get more effective.
Generally, they say you'll get twice as much. The availability will double through composting process. So I think it probably is more than that. Yeah. Either way, you'd need less to get a similar effect. It depends on your soil. It depends on what's going on. Who was it, the 3.4 pH? Who said that? Your 3.4 pH? That's really low.
No matter how much lime I put on, I have never been able to get a soil past 7.
Well, not that you want to go past 7.
No. I have a hard time getting in the 6s.
Yeah.
But these soil tests are in places. I got 3 results back where it's in the mid to low 6s.
That's usually good. So better sign. Your tank is more full.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, on my farm, I generally broadcast these minerals straight out into the ground. I usually keep the soil either green or brown covered. There's not bare soil very often in many places. And I let my dead plant residue fall on the ground and digest. Some people will take your tomato plants out and put them in a compost pile. I let my tomato plants fall into the cover crops. And so I figure to some extent I've got a composting process going on my land, and I'm just saving myself the hassle of carrying things out, turning it, piling it up, hauling it back, and spreading it. Yes.
Never mind.
The reason they do that is because they're afraid of the disease, right? I mean, if you don't have a host habitat, then, you know, your plants aren't sick, they're not, you know, you can have the disease there, but they're not going to get an infection.
Well, I mean, the concept is that you can prevent your plants from getting sick. I'm not sure. There's that argument, and then there's the rotations argument. anybody ever rotated their crops, rotated their summer squash from one section to another? Have you found the powdery mildew didn't define your summer squash after you rotated them?
No.
My experience is powdery mildew follows the squash.
It goes wherever it is.
And the potato bugs follow the potatoes.
Yeah.
And the...
That's true.
Downy mildew follows the basil and the...
This guy has been growing his tomato plants for 18 years in the same tunnel.
Yeah.
And he's never had any fungus or disease.
Right.
And he's really into nutrient.
Yeah, exactly.
And if I could say one more thing, I took a nutrient management class for NRCS.
Yeah.
So I thought it was going to help me with my farm. But...
Implication being it didn't.
It didn't. Well, the one thing we never discussed through this whole week of this class was that you could put too much. You were to go with the report that came out, and if it said you needed 1,000 pounds of lime,
yeah,
you put 1,000 pounds of lime on it. Whether it, and here it says this is the most you should put on. Mm-hmm. That in the discussion never came up.
I'm only getting it from people who've been doing it longer than I have.
Yeah.
And this is something they're pretty clear about.
Yeah.
They're like, you know what, your tank may be really empty, but don't fill it all at once.
Watch out. Well,
slow and steady.
Comes out and reads your report and says, well, you've got to put 2,000 pounds of this on.
People told to put 2 or 3 pounds of tons of lime down per acre, and it shuts the system down.
Yeah.
You put down all that lime all at once, and it'll give your soil indigestion, and everything goes...
Yeah.
And yeah. A couple tons of lime will do it. A couple tons of lime will do it. If you don't, especially if you don't have good biological activity, it'll absolutely do it. Absolutely. So, anyway. Interesting. So, you've got the basic math here. I want to just run through like 4 different elements. I'll do one more on the board, and then you can practice doing one, and then we'll see how much longer you need to keep doing this. It's really simple. The math is really simple. I'll erase this. Once you figure it out, you're like, oh, I got this. For those who want supplemental reading, there is a really good book called The Ideal Soil by Michael Estera, I believe, which is like an 85-page handbook, The Ideal Soil. Which walks you through how to do this. It's all written down. It's got paragraphs. It's got explanations. Michael Estera, Astera. I believe you can get it on soilminerals.com. Soilminerals.com, which is actually one of the 2 or 3 websites where you can actually upload your soil report data, and they'll spit out recommendations for you. The only problem with these sites is that they will not have this max application rate per year. They will give you everything, because they're then selling you also the minerals. So one always must question the incentive behind people's actions.
What do you
actions.
Think of the book, The Intelligent Gardener?
Also good. It's much more comprehensive. It's one of the better sort of comprehensive books out there, I think. The Intelligent Gardener, recently published like 2 or 3 years ago, Steve Solomon, The Intelligent Gardener. And he's got a website also where you can upload your soil report readings, and he'll spit out recommendations for you and sell you minerals. Yes. I like people to have the idea that they can do it themselves and not need to trust somebody else. I just, on principle, think that's a good idea. But most people want to ask somebody else to do it for them. So, anyway, let's do boron on here. Okay? So, I will write on the board while you guys tell me what to do. What's the first step? Boron. Usually something goes above that.
0.38 ppm times 2.
Boron is 3 ppm.
All right. Now 0.38. All set? Subtract. Is it 2.4?
5.24 pounds per acre of boron.
All right. Nothing too sophisticated here. I think you might need to look at the top of page 4 to find
maximum application.
Now, first you got to figure out what you're going to use. Borax is the common borax soap that one might find in a grocery store. Generally, people with backyard gardens will use that. Solubor or boric acid is generally used by farmers. We get it in 50-pound bags. It's and generally ends up being less expensive. It's harder to find, but it's less expensive. So what do you guys want to use? Solubor? Borax. The votes are very close here. Solubor? We got two more votes for Solubor. Okay. So we're using Solubor. All right. What do we do? Divide. Solubor. We had a majority of votes for Solubor. So we do 5.24 divided by 0.2. Yes? Everybody's following?
No.
No. So Solubor is 20% boron. It's on the top of page 4. Where is page 4? Right there. It's all in there somewhere. You can make notes to yourself if you want. Okay, everybody's figured it out now? Boron is 20% boron in Solubor, so 5.24 divided by 0.2 equals? 26.2 pounds per acre Solubor. Is that the answer?
Nope, because the max you can do is 15.
That's not the answer because that's the max. The max is lower than that. Mm-hmm. So the answer is 15 pounds per acre. I'll write this. I'll write it in PPA.
How frequently should you take a sample?
Great. I generally recommend an annual soil test. I generally recommend the fall equinox.
Where was the
map? Bottom of page 3.
Sorry, I didn't hear what you said. I was looking
for boron. If you circle the slides that have critical things on them and make arrows, it's sometimes easier to find them later. The question was, when do you take soil tests or how often? I generally recommend an annual soil test for the first couple of years. I generally suggest the fall equinox is a good time to take a soil test. You don't want to be putting down 15 pounds of Solubor over your vegetables. You may easily burn things. So generally when your cover crops are established at the end of the growing season is when I want to be putting down things like this. Trace elements in general are unnatural materials. Borax is not. Solubor is. Copper sulfate is unnatural. Manganese sulfate is unnatural. Zinc sulfate is unnatural. What's that?
The sulfates are also fungicides, so you kill your good fungus.
So there's a couple things about how you apply them. Just for starters, everything here is approved for certified organic farms, but it's called restricted use. because they're not naturally occurring. The basic rule for organic is if it's naturally occurring, you can use it. If it's not naturally occurring, you can't. So they're not naturally occurring, but they're critical, and the science tells us they're critical, so you're allowed to use them anyways. But they are, you know, they're unnaturally occurring. They're really concentrated, potentially toxic, so you ought to be careful in how evenly or broadly you spread them. That's the biggest issue, I think, here. They come in various forms. You can find soluble grade, which is like they're soluble crystals you can put in water, mix them with humates or molasses, and spray them out with a boom sprayer. That's a good way to get them evenly spread across the land. The basic rule of thumb, as far as I'm concerned, when it comes to applying trace elements, is you want to buffer them with a carbon source. You don't want to put them down straight or raw. They are salts, and they'll burn the soil life, basically. So my basic rule of thumb when you're putting down trace elements, and really minerals in general, is mix them with a carbon source. A finely, you know, ground humates, you can use biochar, you can use compost. If you're putting things out in a sprayer or in a boom sprayer, you can mix them with sugar, you can mix them with molasses. Those are carbons, right? Or you can put them into a compost pile and let the compost pile digest them, and then they won't be salts at all. They'll be bioavailable. There's various ways of doing it. What I do on my farm is generally the most simple process, which is I mix them with, I'll take a wheelbarrow, I'll put some humates or some, you know, any kind of, you know, I use humates actually, or biochar usually. I'll fill the wheelbarrow half with humates, and then I'll pour the trace elements in, and I'll stir them all up, and then I'll pour it out into 5 gallon buckets, and then I go out onto the land and start whipping them out out of a 5 gallon bucket. That's what I do. If you've got a manure spreader and you go out and spread manure in the spring, or at some point in time, take a handful and spread it across the full manure spreader before you go out each time. And that'll take them, and that'll spread them out across the field. If you're already making passes with something else, spreading something else, you would just basically bulk them, mix them in to whatever else is going out there. Ideally, you want to bulk them out with some kind of a carbon.
When you mentioned biochar, is this pure, clean, original biochar, or has this been inoculated and gone through the process?
This is pure, straight biochar. We didn't talk about biochar. It is on my list here. I'll just do a quick overview of biochar, because I think it's a curious topic. People may have heard about it and have questions. Biochar is basically charcoal, which is basically wood burned in the absence of oxygen. People may know about this. Pyrolysis is a technical term. It became popular in the alternative ag world about, I don't know, 6, 8, 10 years ago. It was a little while ago now. There are reports of this stuff called terra preta, which is Portuguese for black earth. Archaeologists were studying ancient cities, basically, on the edge of the Amazon. Who knew there were tens of millions of people living in the Amazon in big cities when Columbus first came? Anybody know about this? Millions and millions and millions of people, amazing civilizations in the Amazon that all died. When the germs came, all dead, and their houses were all wood, and so they rotted away, and the only residue we've got are these areas of black earth where, you think soil, you've got red soil here, go down to the Amazon, that soil is really worn out, right? Except there's these areas where the soil is rich and dark, and they're like, what's going on? How did this happen? And apparently they were doing, instead of slash and burn, they're doing slash and char, so they would take their tree tops and limbs and things like that, and instead of burning them to make ash, they would burn them in the absence of oxygen to make charcoal. And then they put that charcoal in the soil. And charcoal, biochar, has tons and tons and tons of these bonding sites. We talked about the exchange capacity thing with the sand and the clay and the bonding sites. Well, biochar, charcoal, has ridiculous exchange capacity, like 400, I think. We talked about 8 to 12 being normal. It's just massively, massively higher, and it doesn't break down. It doesn't digest in the soil. It doesn't easily get turned into carbon dioxide. So they would do the slash and char thing. They put it in the soil, and they'd have this larger exchange capacity, and capture the nutrients, and basically have this rich black earth. And so this has been this really burgeoning interest a lot among, I would call them gadget heads, people who are like tools and gizmos and making things and trying to make money selling things and trying to figure out how we can make lots of biochar and sell it. And the biggest issue with biochar has been it's a pain in the butt to make it, and it costs a little bit of money. And if you're talking about applying tons of biochar per acre and it costs you $1 a pound, you're talking about spending thousands and thousands of dollars per acre to put biochar down, and that's not going to happen because farmers aren't going to pay for it. So what I've come across recently is a byproduct from the wood-fired power plants. There's one in New Hampshire where I'm getting my stuff from, and basically the lumber mills, or you know, the lumber guys will take all the lumber grade wood, but all the slash, all the branches and stuff, they chip and burn it in power plants, wood-fired power plants. But they have this residue at the end, which is not just ash. It's this like charcoal, basically. And they got these massive piles of it, and it's basically free, $5 a yard or a ton. So you can actually get, you know, pretty high quality biochar, which also has some wood ash in it, which is, you know, got calcium and got potassium, so you got a low pH, it'll help raise your pH for next to nothing. And it's a really nice material. So short question, long answer.
Well,
follow up.
I'll bring some biochar tomorrow.
Some inoculated fancy
stuff.
I have
stuff. Some uninoculated.
Beautiful.
And
for people to see it.
I'll show pictures of my Contiki kill that I can make about a 55-gallon drum of biochar in 6 hours.
Nice. Yeah. There's all kinds of stuff online if you look it up about biochar. People are really, a lot of people are getting really excited about it. There's suggestions about biochar being a way to sequester carbon, which doesn't make any sense to me at all. So please take that out of your mind. Anybody who says we should cut down all the trees to burn them to sequester carbon, I think is missing something. Yes?
That doesn't speak well of coal ash, does it?
I have heard some amazing things about coal ash, and it depends entirely on how it's burned and where the coal comes from, what's in the coal. There's burnt lime, which potentially is really good too, fly ash, which is, depending on what it's like, it's coal ash. I know some guys out in Iowa who have this coal ash that they are spreading on fields, and at appropriate rates are getting amazing effects with. They're Reams people. They're doing Reams stuff, and I remember I was at this event, and they had a little styrofoam cup of the coal ash, and they poured some water into it, and the thing started smoking and fizzing and melted the cup. I'm like, Jesus, what's in this stuff? It was just the coal ash. It was the fly ash from the coal-fired power plant, but it had so much energy in it, so many nutrients in it, spread out at, you know, half a ton per acre or a ton per acre, you know, had a massive effect on the corn yield. So, I don't know.
Well, there's two different things. You got fly ash, that's stuff that's going up the chimneys that they're trying to neutralize with carbon dioxide or calcium carbonate.
Yeah.
To get this sulfuric.
To pull the sulfur out.
Sulfur's out, so you don't get sulfur.
So we don't get acid rain.
Acid rain, and then you have the leftover mineral portion of the coal, which
yep.
where all the carbon was burnt off. But that could be, unless they vaporized all the mercury and stuff and put it into the air, you're going to get lots of that stuff in there, which could be toxic real soon.
So I don't know is the answer.
I'd stay away from it. They were using some of that to put it into as a building material for concrete. Not concrete, but the cement in the concrete.
Yeah.
And there were issues with that the concrete was all going to be full of toxic materials.
I know that as an organic farmer, or not an organic farmer, but one who follows organic basic regulations, I'm not allowed to use burnt rock, which coal ash counts as. So I never have used it on my farm. I have heard reports of people who I trust using something and having positive results. As with anything, it's better to know what you're putting into your land before you put it on. I like to use the example of cow manure. Anybody who gets cow manure or cow manure compost and puts it on their land, understand that 6 yards per acre of cow manure or tons per acre of cow manure equals a double dose of Roundup. There is a double dose of Roundup in 6 tons per acre of cow manure if your cows are fed grain. If composted chicken manure, we have this thing in the Northeast called Cheap Cheap. It's this composted chicken manure from chicken houses, which is what all the organic farmers use as a nitrogen source. All the GMOs, all the Roundup, all the growth hormones that were coming out of the rear ends of the conventional chickens is in this composted chicken manure, and that's certified organic. So if you're ever bringing anything in from off-site onto your land, know what it is, don't trust the label, ask questions, use common sense. When in doubt, don't bring anything in, right? I mean, in some cases, it's valuable to bring things in, but understand the whole supply chain, understand where things are coming from. There's a larger conversation here. If you want to know what you're putting into your body before you put things into your body, consider your land to be your body. Know what you're putting into your body, know where it's coming from. Don't just trust somebody else or say it's really inexpensive, so therefore, it's a good deal. There's a lot of industrial waste which is passed off on farmers. We have this thing called sewage sludge. You know about sewage sludge? They got some fancy name for it. Biosolids. Yeah, organic fertilizer. It's organic because it came out of your rear end, along with all the paint thinner that got dumped down the drain, along with all the pharmaceuticals that are in people's systems, along with all the antibiotics that are in people's systems. Right? People dump all kinds of things down the drain, and that's in your biosolids. That is not allowed in the dump because it's too toxic. Right? They would put it in the dump if they could, but they can't because they tested it and they found it was illegal to put in the dump. And they got to do something else with it. Now they're selling it to farmers or giving it to farmers. Spreading it all over the fields, calling it cheap fertilizer. Understand what you're bringing in. If it's inexpensive and somebody's happy to deliver it to you for free, there's probably a reason. Probably a reason. Not because they're doing it out of the goodness of their heart. Sorry, I get worked up every now and then.
Would you create a grogginess dynamic or some other problem if you applied too much biochar to clay soil, or would that maybe just happen if it was only an uninoculated charcoal?
So biochar is a big tank, but it is, if it's straight biochar, it's an empty tank.
Right.
And so the effect that people have found of putting down lots and lots of biochar straight onto the ground is that it basically sucks the nutrients out of the soil and holds them and causes the yields to drop for the first couple of years. And so the best thing to do with biochar is to put it in a compost pile when you're building it. And all those nutrients that otherwise would volatilize and leach out are going to be held by the biochar. If you're operating at a human scale, you put it in a 5-gallon bucket and you pee into the bucket until it stinks.
And that's because even though urine is sterile, once it's out of your body, it then will begin to collect.
It will. So all the nutrients in your urine will be held by the biochar, and the tank won't be empty anymore when you put that under the garden.
5 gallons of biochar into the gallon of urine. After 3 weeks, you cannot have a smell of any kind.
Yep. Absolutely. And it'll be really an amazing fertilizer. Yeah. Anyway, I can digress on all kinds of topics all day long.
Sorry.
I try not to, but I can't control myself.
Some of the stuff you've been doing on the board. One, where can we find the pH explanation in literature that's the clearest that you've found? And then second is a walkthrough of this doing the math stuff located anywhere.
Where have I seen this pH thing explained? I didn't understand pH, and I don't remember who it was that I asked, and they just basically drew it out for me like I drew it out for you. I'm like, oh, that only makes sense. So I don't think I read it anywhere. As far as walking out the minerals thing, I said the Ideal Soil by Michael Astera is good. The Intelligent Gardener lays it out. I'm not sure how well he lays it out. I know the Ideal Soil, basically the whole book, is about how to do this. That's it. It's nothing else. The Intelligent Gardener is more of the broader conceptual framework. Shall we do one more element to get this a little more solid in your noggins?
Yep.
All right. So we're going to do this one, and I'm not going to do it on the board. You're going to do it yourself, and we'll see how much you learned. This is a test. Shall we do manganese? Manganese, which is not magnesium. Manganese is 2 below boron. Knock yourself out. Go low, go high. Doesn't matter. There's a hint.
Yep.
Yep. Just go to the end. Save yourself the hassle.
Let's see when you carry them. Like,
use way less than that.
Like a quarter pound of boron, or, you know.
You get some result. We'll talk about visual analysis and yield effects tomorrow with trace elements and stuff like that. We'll talk about this tomorrow. Bring up chelation tomorrow when we're talking about manganese. We'll have a nice conversation about it. I think I might be right. I lied. I didn't do it on the board. I'll hide it from the people who haven't come to. Everybody's pretty much done? Maybe. Do you guys want to give a rough, anybody want to venture a guess of what the answer is?
20.
20?
20.
20?
Mm-hmm. 20?
Yeah.
20? For 10 years.
I think it's 400.
400 is 20. Did I give you 20?
What's that?
If you base it on 90 parts per million, 425.
Is what you need.
Right.
Right. I did by 85. You can, either way, doesn't really matter. The upshot here is if you divide 400 by 20, you're looking at a 20-year project.
Yeah.
right? Which is the, I like to use this as a segue into the conversation about rock dust and other sources of minerals which are not solubilized and expensive and unnatural. I started off this conversation talking about how soils that were remineralized were able to maintain productivity over millennia. We've been talking so far about things you can buy in bags. We talked about gypsum, we talked about manganese sulfate, we talked about, you know, solubore. These are all things you can buy in bags. My understanding is that between rock dust and seawater, we literally can access all of the nutrients we need that we don't have on our land. And those are, you know, remarkably inexpensive and locally available in most cases for the planet writ large, not just for here in North America where we have access to money and things in bags. So let me just talk about that for a second. You guys have blacktop? You got a blacktop. Blacktop. You guys know what the ingredients are in blacktop?
Tar?
Tar and?
Asphalt.
Crushed rock. Crushed rock and tar is what they use to make blacktop. The tar comes from Alberta or Venezuela, and the crushed rock comes from a hole in the ground somewhere close by. They call it a quarry. Yeah. Doesn't make any sense to haul rock a long ways because the whole planet's made out of rock. So they usually find somewhere close by and dig a hole and pull it out of there. Right? This is just the way it works. And the quarrying process is basically you drill a hole, you put some explosives in there, you blow it up, come in with the big, you know, front end loader, you pick the rocks up, you dump them into the truck goes over to the crusher crashes up the rocks, you got these screens. The screens, you know, when they hit the right size, they get vibrated off into the pile. And so you got the 1-inch stone, you got the 1/2-inch stone, etc. There's a byproduct of the crushing process, which is called crusher dust or float or fines or rock dust or fill. And generally, there's way more of that manufactured in the process of making, you know, stone than there is a need for, a market for, and that stuff gets dumped back into the hole. So finely crushed rock dust is basically piled up in, you know, hundreds of millions of tons, nicely distributed across the landscape, and the book value on it, if you want to buy it, is $2 a ton or $4 a ton or $6 a ton. Generally, it's relatively close by, you know, 5 miles away or 10 miles away. You're not going to have it, you know, it's not going to be something you need to haul from 500 miles. So anybody with a dump truck, I don't know, where I come from, a dump truck rental is $75 an hour to $100 an hour. So you can do a few runs on 10 miles without costing really that much money. The issue is figuring out what's in your local rock dust. And this is where, unless somebody's willing to do a little bit of legwork and do some and figure it out for you, you're all kind of like, I don't know, we'll just put some down. This is where, you know, this was the impetus behind John Homaker's work, remineralization, remineralize the earth. The organization I started working for basically says, just spread rock dust, that'll solve the world's problems. I think maybe it's a little bit more sophisticated than that. I think it would be helpful to know what's in the rock dust and what's not in your land. And you want to try to match the rock dust that has what your land doesn't have. And if we actually did this systemically across the region, we could do 3-foot deep soil cores, we could map up what's in our local geology, and we could figure out what's in our local quarries, and then you could basically say for the whole area, everybody around needs 3 tons per acre from this quarry, 2 tons per acre from that quarry, and 1 ton per acre from that quarry. And we could, you know, pretty much systemically remineralize people's land across a whole geo region. We call this the soil profile project. It's something that takes a little bit of money to do all the quarrying, all the assaying and math, and we haven't been able to raise the money to do it yet. But if anybody's intrigued by this, I think it's a totally interesting prospect. And the applications for this, not just here in North America, but in Africa and Asia and other places where people are starving to death, I think is extremely intriguing. The other thing you can use to address mineral deficiency systemically, which is natural, is seawater or sea salt. Jerry Brunetti, one of the people I've been referencing a little bit here, one of the elders in our movement, always said 75 pounds per acre of sea salt is a wonderful prophylactic dose. He would always recommend it for graziers, anybody who was, you know, out there running animals, running cows. He said it really helps, especially in the spring flush, keep things balanced. 75 pounds per acre is not a lot of sea salt. People sometimes refer to, I think it was the Romans that salted the Carthaginians' fields, or the Trojans. Anybody know? Remember?
Mm-hmm. The Romans did.
The Romans and the Carthaginians? Anyways, Carthage, I'm not sure where Carthage is, or was, but it's not around anymore. Anybody know where Carthage is? Somewhere in Turkey, or?
Tunisia? Yeah.
Okay, I thought it was east. It's south? All right. They put a whole bunch of salt in their fields, and they fried everything and killed the land, and so the city couldn't, you know, be around anymore.
Well,
right?
Australia has that problem too with their soils, don't they?
I don't think anybody put thousands of pounds of salt per acre. There's a lot of you know, salt buildup in the central valley in California because of salt fertilizers. Wherever you have you know, rainfall that's not sufficient to leach through the soil, you'll have salt build up on the top. But no, this was an active work of spreading salt,
right,
on land to kill it. People say, you know, well, doesn't spreading salt on the land kill the land? And the answer I like to use is, how much salt do you put in the soup? Anybody? About that much?
Mm-hmm.
A pinch? A little bit to taste. Right? Not enough salt makes the soup kind of bland. Too much salt makes the soup unedible. Just enough salt makes the soup, really, the flavors come together very nicely. And so I'm not recommending a ton of salt, but my understanding is a little bit actually is very beneficial.
Where do you find salt on that level, not at the grocery store?
Like, you can buy it in 1-ton totes for $100 a ton. Basically, we've got all these mines in the Midwest. The whole Midwest used to be an ocean. And so we've got 60, 80 foot deep, you know, layers of salt that's mined out. And, you know, stuff I've got is from Kansas, I think. But certainly you can buy, you know, C90, which comes from Baja California. You can buy Himalayan salt. I mean, you can spend a lot of money. You can spend that much money. You know, I think $100 a ton sounds entirely reasonable if you're talking about 75 pounds to the acre. You can do a lot of acres for $100.
Is that raw?
Shipping, depending on where it's coming from and where you are, will be about $100 a ton. Yeah.
Is that something you can buy through you, through your organization?
I haven't talked about the organization yet, but I will talk about it momentarily. As soon as we get done with this minerals section, the mineral depots and all that kind of stuff. Somebody had asked about sourcing trace elements before, so we'll talk about sourcing these things in a second. The point I want to make here is that my understanding is between rock dust and seawater or sea salt, we do have all of the minerals that we would need to remineralize any land on the planet with a little bit of effort. And I see this as a systemically extremely powerful vision for what can be done in large parts of the planet where soils are desertifying rapidly. I like to say, give me the U.S. military budget for Afghanistan for a month, and we'll do Pakistan, right? For another month, and we'll do, I don't know, Madagascar. Another month, and we'll do Tunisia, right? I mean, we can remineralize countries systemically for short money if we actually wanted to use money that's being spent around the world. Of course, that's not how things work, but... The idea here is it's going to happen. We're going to do it. It's going to take a little while till we shift things around. But yeah, I mean, so goes my fantasy world. Yes.
Yeah, have you seen any figures on mined sea salt deposits, like from Kansas versus the dried seawater C90? Is the sodium chloride content and versus trace? Other trace minerals about equal on those or not?
It's up and down. I mean, they generally say that the sodium chloride levels in the C90 is like 96%, and in other sources of salt, it may be 97 or 98% sodium chloride. I was going to give you a recipe tomorrow for how to take the sodium chloride out of sea salt, and so you can get just the trace elements, which is remarkably simple. and requires wood ash and rainwater or lye. And you can take all the sodium chloride out of salt water and just get the trace elements, which is 90 elements. For those who don't know, seawater has 92 different elements in it. It has every single naturally occurring element and at levels and ratios that are very similar to amniotic fluid. People know what amniotic fluid is. It's what's in the bag that the baby grows up in, right? Interestingly, levels and ratios of trace elements in amniotic fluid is extraordinarily similar to levels and ratios of trace elements in seawater. You can precipitate out the sodium chloride and just get the trace elements basically for free. You're obliged to go to the ocean for vacation for 24 hours. So call it a tax write-off, farm expense. I have to go to the ocean to harvest some fertilizer. This is the way I like to frame it. I'll do that. I was going to go over that tomorrow, though. Yes?
So you could argue that our species, which has essentially evolved to a place of being a keystone species,
yes,
needs to adopt on a large scale a process of remineralizing the landscape in a relationship with the ocean in order to carry out the mineral cycle in an appropriate way to respond to our population density per size.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and sequestering carbon.
Right.
And rebalancing the climate. Exactly. And obviating the need for fungicides, insecticides, pesticides, and fertilizer, which will help clean up all the aquifers, the dead zones. And, I mean, yes.
I just mentioned that because when I talk about this stuff with students, I oftentimes feel like it's really helpful to just like, whoa, like, zoom out for a second and look at that big picture.
I think it's remarkably exciting.
Yeah.
I mean, everything we need is right here. The biggest problem with these things, rock dust and seawater, is just too much of them. What happens when there's too much of anything is there's no way to commodify it and sell it. Right? The only way you make money selling things is if there's not enough and you control the supply. There's way too much of this stuff. It can't be sold for a profit, so no one's going to market it, so no one's going to learn about it, so no one's going to use it. That's my cynical perspective. I may not be correct, but I think that's the biggest problem is there's too much. Is this what the planet's made out of?
Have you talked about what to do if we have some mineral that is way too strong in our...
I have not. No. Do you want to give me an example of what that might be?
Here is zinc.
Yes.
You say you want
8.
10 ppa and I've got 23.4.
Yes. So what you will find in many cases, if in areas where people have been using lots of compost, is high zinc levels and high phosphorus levels. That just happens to be that there's lots of zinc and phosphorus in compost. Generally, when you look into these things in more detail, you'll find that it's not just a target level of zinc, but there's also ratios. So you want 2-to-1 zinc to copper. You want 10-to-1 phosphorus to zinc. And so, you know, I can rapidly get people overwhelmed with all this other stuff. It is in the books I referenced if you want to look into it. So you might want to bring your copper level up a little bit. But what I would suggest is you need to use less compost. Generally, excesses are much harder to deal with than deficiencies. And when you have identified what's causing your excess, then you'd want to stop doing it or minimize your efforts. I don't think we need anywhere near as much compost as people think we do. Honestly, I think nature grows things in soil, not in compost. People who do urban gardening stuff think that they have to have, they build their whole soils out of compost, and that's all they've got is compost, there's no soil. I don't think it's quite balanced, personally. So generally what I suggest is the more vital the ecosystem becomes, the more that the life in the soil will tie up things that are in excess. So you may oftentimes find that there's fairly high levels of aluminum in your soil. 800, 1,000, 1,200 are generally high levels. I didn't put aluminum in the handout because people get worked up when they see what it should be, which is more like 200, and they worry about aluminum toxicity. All high levels of aluminum mean is that your soil is worn out and weathered. You will find the aluminum levels will decrease over time as your biological activity increases. 813 is not that bad. I mean, it's normal for weathered soil. Normal for weathered soil. And you will see over time, if you watch your soil tests, aluminum levels will decrease as biological activity increases because life is intelligent and life ties up things that are toxic. So my basic answer is don't worry about it because you can't do anything about it. Address deficiencies, build biological activity, and life will tie these things up. There are lots of documentation of life digesting radiation, radioactive isotopes. There's this family of microbiologists in Austria called the Lubkes, who had the Lubke method of composting that people may have heard of. It was taught at University of Maine, Orono. After Chernobyl in 86, the Austrian government was traveling around in the areas where the radiation was falling and testing people's crops. The USDA version, the Austrian version of the USDA was testing and seeing wherever people had radiation in the milk and the vegetables and whatever, they would say, you can't sell. And they were testing, and all the farms in this area, they all had radiation, and they said, you can't sell your crops, you can't sell your crops, you can't sell your crops. On the Lubke's farm, they couldn't find any radiation. They couldn't find it. It was in all the neighboring farms, but it wasn't on their farm. Because they had such a high-functioning biological ecosystem that they were eating radioactive isotopes for breakfast. Woo! Extra electron, right? The oil spills, PCBs, dioxin, you know, heavy metals. The only thing that can take care of these things is bacteria and fungi. Microbiology are our allies by way of microbiology. It's the bacteria and the fungi that have these capacities. Paul Stamets has, you know, identified specific species that you can go out and you can inoculate if you've got this toxin or this toxin. It is the most efficient way to address all these imbalances, and it's the way the planet's going to get cleaned up as far as I'm concerned. So really what we're trying to do is build life back into the system and get out of the way, because life has the capacity to deal with these things in a way that we, with our, you know, crude technology, don't seem to be able to. So.
Yes.
I'm sorry. I keep not answering, not pointing to you. I go to the left, not to the right. I'm
so
left.
Are you back to me?
No, I, well, sure.
Anyway.
Wait a second. Yeah, I keep asking his questions. Go for it.
So
I'm left-handed.
If you have a source for rock dust,
yeah.
Can you not just package it and send it for a soil test?
You want to do more of a prospecting assay than a regular soil test analysis. And the issue is there's this thing called a reactivity index, and that has to do with basically the chemical bonds, whether they're single bonds or double bonds or triple bonds, and relatively how available the elements are in the rock. And so to properly assess the relative value of a rock dust, you not only want to figure out everything that's in it, but you also want to figure out the chemical structure and the strength of the bonds, which will correlate with the availability of the minerals. And so to survey an area, what you'd like to do is get samples from all, you know, 10, 20, 30 different quarries in the area, and then you run them through about three different assays, and then have somebody who's a geologist and understands the reports look at them. So it'll cost you plus or minus $500 per quarry to get a really thoughtful answer to the question, how valuable is this? Just because something's in there does not mean it's available. And so you don't want to be bothering yourself hauling rock dust around and spreading stuff that's got triple bonded compounds. Those things aren't going to be, you know, soil life is not going to break triple bonds unless it really, really has to. So you want to...
Do you put rock dust on yours?
I have... I don't have a sandbox in my farm. I've got rock dust piles. It's my kids play in.
You haven't tested them? You think they're
okay? I have... yes. Yes.
And it doesn't affect the texture of your soil. I have a friend who decided, read a book somewhere that he needed rock dust.
Yeah.
Got a bunch of it. Put it on his garden, it's like cement.
Yeah, well, you can overdose. You can overdose anything.
Yeah, he's got a cement garden now.
Yeah, they generally say between two and ten tons to the acre, depending on the particle size, and the smaller the particle size, the less you need, and that would be like a generational dose every 20 years or something. So, I think, you know, as far as I'm concerned, there's a massive amount of potential here. Until somebody is willing to put some money into researching this stuff and figuring it out and properly, you know, giving people good recommendations, we're kind of shooting in the dark. I did start out with spreading just random rock dust when I first heard about this stuff. It was like, I don't know, 9 years ago. After we picked the garlic in the area, we were going to put our fall brassicas in. We just spread rock dust just for, you know, fun. And those brassicas were just... They were looking really nice, and it was a pretty short turnaround time. And then the next year we got something that was more like an azomite type material and spread that heavy duty across the entire farm, and the tilth and the texture of the soil really improved. There's all kinds of rock. There's all kinds of forms of the rock. There's all kinds of, it's such a broad conversation that I can lay out the general idea and say, I think there's a lot here, but then going and finding the best, sources and matching the sources with the landscape and finding the local sources for the local landscape is a bit of work. And I've got the geologist who can do it, but he doesn't work for free. And the organization doesn't have any money. And if somebody said this is really important, I want this done for my county or my whatever region, it would be pretty short money to empower a lot of people. But no one's going to make a lot of money on it, so no one's really ponied up the money to do the legwork ahead of time.
So in lieu of rock dust, do you mean rock?
In lieu of rock dust, I do what I taught you to do, which is take a soil test and make recommendations based on the soil test. Yes, I think it works quite well. Yes?
Does sheet mulching tend to lead to zinc and phosphorus overload, or is that just like a year after year kind of sheet mulching that would cause that rather than just garden staff?
Are you speaking to your soil test coming having high levels of zinc and phosphorus?
No. I just signed up for this at 12:30 in the morning.
You were the guy that came in at midnight. Yeah, I saw that this morning. I was like, wonder where he came from. Wonder where he heard about it. I wonder who it is. Didn't tell anybody. I think it's more compost that oftentimes has manure in it that is the cause for the zinc and phosphorus. I don't think it's hay so much.
Okay.
But I don't know. I see with people who use compost, high levels of compost generally show up with high zinc and phosphorus reports on the soil test. Yep, and I need to move on after this question, if that's okay with you guys.
You don't have iron on your target levels of trace elements.
Yes, iron and silicon and actually sodium were brought up. I think those are the only ones. Silicon, we'd like to have it at 50 or above. Iron is 2 times manganese, so it should be 180, but in most cases your iron is way higher than manganese, and so we let it be.
It's not an issue if it's really high.
Nothing you can do about it. As biological activity increases, what you'll find actually with the manganese is that you can put down 20 pounds per acre manganese sulfate and that'll kick things into gear, and you'll begin to see the manganese levels go up faster than the 20 pounds per acre of manganese would suggest they do. And the iron levels go down. And this goes to what I was talking about before lunch, which is the biological transmutation conversation, which is that as life kicks into gear, we see things move around that violates what we think are laws of physics. And it happens over and over again. And we've got data, and therefore we have to look at it if you're actually being a scientist and not a dogmatist, a religious person, as it were. Religious said not with a positive connotation in this case. And sodium, the number here between 0.5 and 3 percent base saturation, I think, is a reasonable one. Now you'll see that the ones in the base saturation percent area I have on the recommendations in the percents, not in actual pounds per acre. All right. As I said before, there's good books on this topic. If you want to look this stuff up yourself, feel free. There's workshops, there's courses. Another good person on this topic is Neil Kinsey. For anybody who's heard of Neil Kinsey, remember what his book's called? Hands-On Agronomy, I think. Hands-On Agronomy is a really good book for people who are serious about acreage. Neil's one of the better consultants in the country when it comes to this kind of stuff. All right, so moving on page 4. We're actually doing all right on time, remarkably, considering. What's that? Congratulations. I'll just expand and contract accordingly. The question is, how many of these questions have been answered already? All right. BFA, slide number 20, top page 4. I'd like to spend at least 5 minutes talking about the organization that is behind this workshop and some of our other and some of his other endeavors. The BFA, I think we're 6 years old now. We have about 500 members. We have about 15 chapters in 10 different states. We are a grassroots, you know, membership-based nonprofit educational organization. Our formal objective is increasing quality in the food supply, as it says there. Our primary work historically has been these two-day courses around the country, which has spread through word of mouth almost entirely. We have a really rudimentary outreach capacity. It's increasing at this point, but really slowly. Our social media and everything else is pretty embarrassing. That's fine. People who are busy on the computer aren't people who want to talk to anyways, right? I got serious farmer bias. So we do these workshops. We do introductory lectures, which some of you attended last month. We are working on a more coherent handbook that'll take this work and lay it out for you in a solid document you can take home, as opposed to this pretty much insufficient, as far as I'm concerned, handout. The website is pretty good. We've got a bibliography on there. We've got audio recordings. We've got video recordings. We've got links to other organizations and sources of materials and recordings from conferences. And I think for those who want to delve more deeply into all this whole topic, I think the website is actually pretty good, considering. It's a work in progress and it's getting better, but that's only because our organization is building. Research is a something we haven't really had enough money to go into as well as we'd like to, although it does seem to be picking up in the past few months, really. I'll just sort of talk about the bionutrient meter here, which has been my fantasy for a number of years, and if we're not careful, we're going to have it out within the next year. Definitely within the next 2 years, maybe in 6 months. The idea, as I talked about at the beginning of the day today, is that there's a spectrum of variation in nutrient levels in crops. We know what a poor quality tomato tastes like. We know what a high quality tomato tastes like. We know that those flavors correlate with compounds, and those compounds in chemistry, actually in physics, are vibrations. Let me explain that one for a second. Anybody heard of Alpha Centauri? Alpha Centauri, it's a star. Apparently it's 4 or 5 light years away, I'm not exactly sure. And it's the closest star to us, which is not the sun. I think it was the Voyager 2 or Voyager 1 are the probes that have been sent out, you know, that have gone the furthest. And they're somewhere close to the edge of the solar system, which is, I don't know, 2 hours, 2 light hours, not light years, but light hours. So we've never sent anything past the edge of the solar system. Alpha Centauri is 4.5 light years away. And you ask any astrophysicist and they'll tell you exactly what Alpha Centauri is made up of. They'll tell you with very much specificity, Alpha Centauri is 51% hydrogen. Alpha Centauri is 48% helium. Alpha Centauri is, 1% of these other gases and these levels and ratios. And they know that, and they can speak to that confidently because every element in chemistry is a vibration in physics. When you read the light coming from Alpha Centauri, all the different elements are vibrating at different frequencies, and you can, if you look at the light with the right frequency range, you can see what Alpha Centauri is made up of. Does that make sense, basically, to people, roughly, sort of? Those who understand chemistry and physics and things, we take their word for it because it seems to work, even though I'm not quite sure, actually. But then again, what is matter? Everybody got into that one? Matter? It's coming into and going out of existence at this really rapid pace. You heard about this? Dark matter is a whole other conversation. No, regular matter, it seems to be, it's not actually there. It's coming into and going out of existence. The whole thing is absolutely, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter, actually. Anyway, the upshot is that if we have the ability to read the light coming off of a star, and we can tell what that star is made up of, we can read the light coming off of a cucumber and see what that cucumber is made up of. And that's where it gets really exciting, because we now have the capacity to mass produce tools that you can hold in your hand that cost you know, $100 or $150, that you can literally flash a light at a cucumber or at a carrot and read the light bouncing off and see what's in the carrot. And so the idea is that we have consumers able to go to the grocery store, able to go to the farmer's market, able to go wherever to the farm stand and go, boop, boop, crap, boop, crap, boop, decent, and buy the best bag of carrots off the shelf, the most flavorful bag of carrots off the shelf, and use money to incentivize business. You know how money works with businesses? They do whatever makes them money, regardless of whether it's good or bad. Heard about this one? Yeah. My understanding is that, you know, what's good is nice, and what makes money is what happens. And until we figure out a way to help people make money doing the right thing, they're not going to do the right thing. And so the idea is if we give consumers the ability to test quality and make their purchasing decisions based on quality, then we'll have an economic driver that'll walk all the way up and down the supply chain to help incentivize farmers and agronomists and wholesalers and retailers to be focusing on quality as an objective as opposed to the other labels. I had a conversation with the regional buyer for Whole Foods a couple of years ago, and I was talking to him about this idea, and I was, you know, kind of saying, hey, would you guys want to help with this? You know, it's going to be really good to do. And they said, you know, not a chance in hell, we're going to help you. But when you're a couple of years out from having this technology, please come tell us, because we'll then give our growers 2 years to meet standard. We're not going to help, but we don't want to be embarrassed when you're able to actually test our crops. So we will change when we know we're going to be embarrassed otherwise, which seems to me to fit entirely in line with human nature. So fine, let's organize. Let's figure out a way to collectively apply, you know, pressure through self-interest to facilitate the changes we're looking for. Well, actually, now it is coming out. Now, I mean, the companies are building the tools. We are building the data sets. This is happening right now. We're talking about having prototypes out, you know, in a few months. This is actually happening now. It wasn't happening before. It is happening now. It's really exciting. We're in for some really exciting times coming down the pike fairly soon. I've said for a number of years, like, when this gets, if I can help pull this thing off, I'm going to retire. Like, I'm done. Mission accomplished in this lifetime. I get to go back to my farm. I got kids. Like, it's nice going out around the country, but it's not that nice. If I do something of consequence, great. I'm going to feel good about myself. No, I won't retire, but yeah, anyways. So that's our research project. That's the meter.
Do you have published somewhere, like, kind of what it will test for, like, specifically?
Well, every single element and every single compound have a resonant frequency. So you're
testing for the elements themselves?
So you flash a light, and what happens is you get what bounces back at you is this whole squiggly of you know, peaks and troughs.
Right.
And then you have to read, you know, you have to, you know, figure out from that what that means is there, and you have to build the algorithms, which requires a decent amount of back-end, you know, testing. The real issue is, what is quality? You know, we can tell you what's in the carrot, but we can't tell you whether it's good or not. Right. Okay. We can spend $700 testing the carrot, or we can flush it with a light and test it. But either way, we still don't know what quality is because no one's figured out what's good and what's bad. So that's the real project, is to take all the data we collect and put it out in the open source literature for people to look at, and to have thoughtful people begin to build algorithms that say, this looks better than that, and then maybe we can actually start feeding some of these things to animals and seeing what the effect is, to correlate what we think quality is with how life responds to it.
So have you started publishing any of that data?
We have not published any of that data yet. The biggest data sets that I've got my hands on are coming from companies that have been doing this work for their own interests with tissue tests and soil tests. Ideally, we want to correlate what's going on in the soil, what are the mineral levels, what's going on with the life in the soil, the microbiome, what cultivars you're using, which varieties, who are the mother plants, because you get your green Swiss chard from here, and your green Swiss chard from there, and the mother plants had different life experiences, and you put them into the same soil, and they perform differently. So, you know, only when we can begin to assess all these things can we actually give farmers good advice about what to do to grow healthier plants. So, for me, this is a much larger project of assessing what are the environmental conditions that correlate with quality, and as part of that, what is quality.
So, do you feel like the role for the organization is to do these studies or to aggregate some of the other information?
To make enough noise and to create the structure to inspire people to engage. We absolutely are running on chicken scratch.
Yeah.
You know, we do not have the capacity to do this work ourselves. It's simply a question of leveraging people's self-interest. Who wants to help us? Who likes us? Who thinks we're doing good work? Who thinks they can benefit if they work with us? Can we build enough momentum that we get actually some buzz, and then it's going to be the bandwagon effect? Anybody cynical about humans and how they work in here? Right? You just got to be realistic. What's that?
I'm cynical about humans and how they work.
Yes, exactly. So let's just deal with it and figure out a way that we can try to leverage people's self-interest, enlightened self-interest, to do what they wouldn't otherwise do. I don't know, it's a good project. You know, it's good challenge, I think. So I'm happy to talk about it in more detail with people who want to. The final thing I want to talk about probably is our local chapter piece, which is we'd like to help growers do a better job growing high quality food, because the idea is when this technology comes out, when the capacity comes out, when the idea comes out that, oh my God, some food is better and some food is worse, there's going to be a lot of people looking for high quality food. And the issue is that most of us growers don't really know very well what we're doing. And so how can we create the environment for us to learn and grow together? Because if we all try to do it by ourselves, it's going to take forever. And so we've come up with this idea of a local chapters, somewhat like the Weston Price Foundation, for those who are familiar with Weston Price, that are basically autonomous and self-organized. And we've got a number of chapters now around the country that are meeting on a monthly basis and walking people through the growing season. Okay, it's October, what should we all be doing? Let's take our soil tests, let's read our soil tests, let's make recommendations together. Those people who are good at math can help those people who aren't good at math. And then let's figure out what we all need together for minerals and see if we can buy them in bulk so we all save money, as an example. So part of what we're doing with the local chapters is what we call mineral depots, and we've got a few depots now set up across the country. We've got one in Iowa, we've got one in Ohio, we've got one in Massachusetts, we're setting up one in Connecticut, and there's some in Pennsylvania. So we're basically trying to get people access to a lot of these things which are difficult to find otherwise, like copper sulfate and zinc sulfate and manganese and cobalt and molybdenum and some of these inoculants. They're available, you can find them, but trying to find good sources, good quality, good prices, and make it available to people who otherwise wouldn't get their hands on it. You know, regular meetings, people hopefully are being inspired by this conversation today, but then you leave and you're like, oh my God, now what do I do? There's way too much information, how can I possibly apply it? So having a group of people to meet with and work together with, and a community to connect with around it, is something we're trying to help establish. We're not pushing it. Anybody who doesn't want to, no pressure. If you'd like to, the structure is there. Jessica and Vale up here in the front are helping to coordinate that, so anybody who's interested should feel free to talk to them. I think that's basically it about the organization. So. Maybe more than 5 minutes, hopefully not too much longer. Yeah, that's what we're up to. Inoculation is the next topic on the agenda. I think I talked about this this morning when I was talking about the basic sort of overall overarching system. The idea was that as we need colostrum when we're born to help establish gut flora, plants also need colostrum when they're born to help establish gut flora. And even throughout their life cycle, inoculating your plants is a really amazingly powerful process for helping kick into gear the overall biological system. Of all the things I talk about during the workshop, in this course, I think inoculation is the least expensive, in many cases, most simple, most powerful, best bang for your buck, lowest hanging fruit process of everything I'm going to talk about. It's really remarkably simple. You can apply inoculation through the growing season. My thought is that at the beginning, when you're planting your seed, is probably the most critical moment. You really want to help establish that gut flora at birth for your plants. I personally use dry inoculants. Anybody who's ever planted a bean or a pea, anybody ever used bean and pea inoculants? You're familiar with bean and pea inoculant. You can buy them from Johnny's and places like that. I think there's two species of legume nitrogen fixers in bean and pea inoculant. These are the guys that live inside the nodule, right? Azotobacter and rhizobacter, I think it is. So we're familiar with the idea of adding spores of bacteria to seeds when we plant. The idea is that we should have, you know, ideally dozens of families of bacteria and fungi present on the seed when you plant. You really want to have a broad spectrum of species present because they're the ones that that are feeding the plant and helping the plant establish as it moves forward. It's really remarkably inexpensive. An ounce of a good inoculant which has 50 different species in it might cost you $8. Depending on if you get a pound, it'll cost you $50 or $30. That'll go for hundreds of pounds of seed. A pound of inoculant will. An ounce of inoculant will be 50 pounds of seed at least, if it's vegetable seed. If it's grain seed, it'll probably be more. So very inexpensive, very simple. You simply take the inoculant, you put it on the seed. I open all my seed packets when I get them and just take a pinch and just go like this. Pinch into each seed packet. There are dozens and dozens of products on the market.
I have a liquid inocular.
It's stable liquid inoculant. I'm generally a little more skeptical of the liquids. If you look up inoculants online, you can go to our website. You can we have done reports in some of our newsletters on some of the companies that are out there around the country and some of the products that they sell. There are a number of really good, really high-quality inoculants out there on the market that, in many cases, are very inexpensive. I'll say this again, lowest-hanging fruit, pretty much best bang for your buck, easiest, simplest, cheapest for the result you're going to get of all the things I'm going to be suggesting through the course. So I strongly, strongly suggest inoculation, and there's not a hell of a lot to say beyond that. I'm not sure.
We did some trials with some this year that have a lot of species of beneficial microbes and fungi, as well as some mycorrhizal. And also, there's one without mycorrhizal for non-mycorrhizal plants, but it has micronized trace minerals, so the Dynamen that Jared Brunetti, naturally mined mineral salt.
Which is very similar to
azomite. But they micronized it, so it's super fine powder. And you basically mix that on the seed, and then you spray it with a chelating agent that starts everything. We saw a big difference in the seed germination.
Big effect. Yeah. Albrecht did this research as well with putting micronized minerals, calcium, and other trace elements on the seed, and seeing lifetime effects on the plant of having just a really remarkably small amount of these elements on the seed when it was planted. In many cases, if you don't have those elements in your soil, you don't have them in your potting soil, if you're starting seeds inside, seedlings inside, getting the inoculants, getting the minerals onto the seed when you plant is a really easy, inexpensive way to kick things into a gear to the next level. It's not necessarily going to take you all the way, but if you're operating at 10% of functionality and you go to 15%, what do they call that? Call that a 50% increase in yield. Anybody?
Way more than that, though.
50% increase in yield.
It was over.
Okay, so fine, 100% increase of yield. You go from 10% functionality to 20% of functionality, you're still a failure, right? 20% is horrible in just about everything, but if you just doubled your yield, you don't really care because all of a sudden, things are looking up, right? Sorry, there's a question in the back. Yes?
What's the storage, the shelf life on?
Shelf life on dry inoculants, my understanding is like 10,000 years.
As long as you don't let it get really hot, don't leave it in your truck or in a shipping container that's metal in the sun.
kept within reason, you know, better than cockroaches in a nuclear holocaust, right? I mean, they're spores. They're the egg form of bacteria and fungi. They are ridiculously stable. You don't get them wet. As soon as they get wet, boom, that game over. So within reason on temperatures is helpful, but even still, you can push it. But yeah,
So below 30% humidity or something, relative humidity.
Ideally, you got them in a sealed container.
Sealed bat, yeah. Seal them like double seal and stuff.
We get this similar effect by putting compost or compost tea in our starting mixes.
So compost tea is an inoculant. That's what it is. Compost tea is all these microbes that you're putting onto your, that's what you're doing with compost tea, is you're inoculating. That's exactly what it is, primarily. It's got some other goodies in there too. But as far as I'm concerned, primarily it's an inoculant. And compost, a really good compost, will have a beautiful spectrum of biology in it. And if you're starting your seeds in a really good compost, then you probably don't need to inoculate in the first place. Worm castings are amazing. If you take your, if you got a worm bin and you're making worm castings and you put some minerals into the worm bin, then the worms will digest them and put them into their castings, and you've got the biology, right? I mean, there's actually applying a lot of this stuff is really simple if you want to make it yourself or you can buy it, but the concept is to understand the role of all these things.
Yeah.
And then you find the people in your local area who are a little farther down the road, and they can help you. And we start learning together and applying together. I like to talk about, there's a book which I have with me, but I don't have it today because I didn't bring it with me. It's called How to Grow World Record Tomatoes. Anybody seen this book? How to Grow World Record Tomatoes? Published by Acres USA. There's this really nice redneck, you know, southern boy from Alabama. Good old farm boy. Smart, right? Common sense. Nobody's fool. He said, I want to be in the world Guinness Book of World Records. And so it took him 5 years to figure it out. He wanted to grow be the most productive tomatoes. And the year he got into the Guinness Book of World Records was in the mid-80s, I think. One tomato plant there, one tomato plant here, one tomato plant there, one tomato plant there. Four tomato plants, 5 feet on center, 1,320 pounds of tomatoes. 1,320 pounds of tomatoes on four plants, averaging between 28 and 32 feet tall. It's a picture book. You can see the pictures, right? You don't just believe him. Here's the pictures of him next to his tomato plants,
yeah.
Right?
Over what
blows
period
your mind.
Of time?
What's that?
Over what period of time?
One growing season. He's from Alabama, so it's a little bit longer than it is here. But either way, so your tomatoes only get to 20 feet tall and only produce 200 pounds per plant instead of 320 or 340, whatever it is. Either way, my thought is that if this stuff is true and we can support each other in beginning to do better, there's no way to convince other people better than leading by example,
yeah.
Right? I mean, a couple years ago, I was giving this workshop in Connecticut, and I made reference to 7 foot tall eggplants. And this guy in the audience, he called me out. He said, bullshit, bullshit. I said, bring it on. This guy, he's a doctor, medical doctor. He's worked with the UN on nutritions and you know, childhood, you know, whatever. Like, he knows his science. He's a proper, confident, empowered guy. And, what's his name? Rodney Hornbake. Dr. Rodney Hornbake. And he said, bullshit. I said, let's go. And so he said, I'll do whatever you tell me to do, and then we'll see. I said, great. So, what's that? No, give me a soil test. I gave him recommendations. I said, I walked him through the growing season. And he came back to the workshop the next year and put together a little PowerPoint that he presented at lunch. And he said, my name is Rodney Hornbake, and this is my 7 foot tall eggplant. He said, I had no idea. I had no idea what was possible. I had never given my eggplants enough space to have them even, right? And there's all these things. If it's true that the yield potential of our plants that we're realizing is 10%. That means there's 90% more that they could produce.
Isn't that what they say about our brains?
And our brains and our whole overall, right, we know about this. Our potentials are great. So, the idea is if we begin to implement some of this stuff, and we get the results and show people, then it'll spread and leading by example. I'm not sure what got me on that tangent about inoculation, but.
Who are they nutritious?
Who are they nutritious?
All plants aren't all nutritious.
I was wondering about that too. What was the nutrition?
I don't think he was testing it. He was kudzu compost was one of his major ingredients for feeding them, and yes, he did take all the leaves off when he transplanted them, because we always want the root system to be bigger than the top. He was critically, we'll talk about seed in a second, he was like absolutely anal about the seed. You must use the biggest seed. The mother plant, the grandmother plant, the great-grandmother plant all have to have been healthy, right? You don't get healthy people from sickly parents. It doesn't happen, right? Only when they start to eat better will you start to improve over the generations as opposed to fall apart over the generations, which is historically what's been occurring, at least in the past couple generations. We know about this. We know about how these things work. We know when the mother is sickly, she's not eating well, she's got diabetes, et cetera, she's likely to have sickly babies, right? If you've got cows, you cull the weak ones, right? You want to keep the best genetic stock, you do the same thing with your seeds. Sorry. I'm going on to the next topic. Should we take a quick break here before it gets too late in the afternoon? It's about 20 after 3. Break till 3:30.